Words cannot describe its beauty as upon the stem it grows. Matchless in his glory, oh, the tender little rose. With his pale doors now broken, greatest beauty it showed. Far more sweeter the fragrance of heaven's sweet rose, the most beautiful rose was broken one day, nailed to a tree on a hill far away, forsaken by his friends, bruised by his foes. How sweet is the fragrance of heaven's sweet rose. Now they laid that broken rose in a borrowed tomb, and home the third day, oh, that rose again did bloom. From the heights of heaven down to the deepest hell, the fragrance of heaven's rose, oh, continually dwells. The most beautiful rose was broken one day, nailed to a tree on a hill far away, forsaken by his friend, bruised by his foes. How sweet is the fragrance of heaven's sweet rose. Glory to God. Every time God saves a soul, heals the sick or delivers the oppressed, the fragrance of heaven's rose is smelled when Jesus walks into the room. And you can't explain it, because words cannot describe his beauty as upon the stem and rose. Matchless in his glory, oh, the tender little rose. With his pale doors now broken, greatest beauty it shows. Far more sweeter the fragrance of heaven's sweet rose, the most beautiful rose was broken one day, nailed to a tree on a hill far away, forsaken by his friends, bruised by his foes. How sweet is the fragrance of heaven's sweet rose.
But, let me see if I can. One night while upon life's raging seas, looked as if I would suffer defeat. Darkness of night closed off the light, my heart sank with fear. I knew my destruction was a matter of time. Jesus stepped in and said, "This old boy's mine. I'm safe from all harm, for he walked through the storm, came looking for me. He came looking for me. He came looking for me. He made a way when there was no way that I could see. When I drifted far, Jesus was near. Rescue my soul and calm my fears. I'm safe from all harm, for he walked through the storm, came looking for me. had already picked out my grave. His plan had moved forward to put me away. I drifted so far, would anyone care that I should be lost? I knew my destruction was a matter of time. Jesus stepped in and said, this one is mine. I'm safe from all harm, so he walked through the storm. Came looking for me. He came looking for me. He came looking for me. He made a way when there was no way that I could see. When I drifted far, Jesus was near to rescue my soul and calm my fears. I'm safe from all harm, for he walked through the storm. Came looking for me. I'm safe from all harm, for he walked through the storm. Came looking for me.
Tomorrow,
the gates of pearl swing open wide. When I have passed this veil of sorrow, I will camp upon the other side. Someday beyond the reach of mortal kin, someday stand still, and I shall go dwell on Zion's hill. Soon storm clouds will be lifted beyond the shadows of the tomb. With all the bells in heaven ringing, and the angels sing a home sweet home, and someday beyond the reach of mortal kin, someday the wheels of moonlight will all stand still, and I shall go dwell on Zion's hill.
Well, let's all go down to the river. There's a man that's walking on the water. Come along with me, for I want to see this man walking on the water. Well, he can raise the dead from the grave, change the water and turn it into wine. He can make the lame walk. He can make the lame walk, open up the eyes of the blind. Let's all go down to the river. There's a man that's walking on the water. Come along with me, for I want to see this man walking on the water. Well, Jesus is the man at the river, and he's washing people's sins away. He can save your soul if you give him control. Be ready for that judgment day. Let's all go down to the river. There's a man that's walking on the water. Come along with me, for I want to see this man walking on the water. This man walking on the water.
Well, we had 70 in Sunday school this morning. thank the Lord for that. Anyone that didn't come, if you should come a little earlier, we count you next week, Lord willing. Announcements we have. Trip to the Popple's farm is on the bulletin board. There's a flyer about it. And the one that's going needs to be signed up by October the 9th. So they'll know a head count for the meals and lunch will be provided at Social Hall for to go on the 16th. But the 9th is the deadline for the sign up. 16th is the actual date you go. You want to buy the tickets in advance, so you don't have to wait in line. Who likes to wait in line? We thank the Lord for everyone here this morning. We thank him for all his blessings. And we pray that you come seeking a blessing from the Lord and that he'll give it to you. We thank you.
Well, good morning. Well, it's good y'all could talk back to me. Can you do it a little bit friskier than that? Good morning.
Good morning.
I know y'all's heart was beating because your mouths was moving anyway. That's good. Let's stand together and sing this worship song together. Shout to the Lord.
Thank you.
Jim, let's sing one that we might know a little bit back in the day. He keeps me singing as I go. Before you guys get going, I already got my main man up front. If y'all will just step aside and let Bradley be seen. Hold on, Bradley. Bradley is a walking miracle. He has turned 48 years old. Amen. So we're going to sing happy birthday, all right? Happy birthday to Bradley. Happy birthday to Bradley. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you. Amen. Y'all can take it back.
C.W. Rickens, I would sing this Mud Lake song for him. But there's a history behind this song. Every summer, we picked a backer. I was raised on the internet. We were raised in the backer fields. That was our cash crop down in this area of South Georgia. So to motivate us, Daddy would say, I'll take y'all all to Mud Lake after we get the backer picked. So we went to Mud Lake. And on Wednesdays, we pass out food at the church. And I told two friends of mine, Mike Hendricks and Gene Price, that I'd like to go to Mud Lake one more time. And they took me to Mud Lake. But it didn't turn out to be a good experience. I got stuck in the mud. When Daddy took us, it was always dry. The mud was hard. But this time it had been full the whole winter, and the mud was, it got me. So listen to the words of this song. You'll like it. I know how Mud Lake got its name. I know how Mud Lake got its name. There's mud, mud, mud in every stream. I know how Mud Lake got its name. My military friends and brothers in church took me fishing in their pickup truck. Hey, we went through puddles that you can't go, but the four-wheel drive made it so. We got to the lake right on time. I got my tackle and I fixed my line. I hung a fish and knew he was big. He broke my line and tore my rig. I couldn't move, the mud was tight. I prayed to God with all my might. I felt his love like never before. It was God's grace, he had opened the door. With all my might, I crawled out. I learned that day how to shout. Life is a lot like Mud Lake. Stay alert, for goodness sake. I know how Mud Lake got its name. I know how Mud Lake got its name. There's mud, mud, mud in every stream. I know how Mud Lake got its name.
He ought to have known if it took a four-wheel drive to get in there that he couldn't walk with his two-wheel drive around that place, but we're glad he's back with us. We're going to sing one more. Stand with me, if you will. We're going to sing, Won't It Be Wonderful There.
When with the Savior he entered the glory land, won't it be wonderful there? Ending the troubles and cares of the story land, won't it be wonderful there? Won't it be wonderful there? Having no burdens to bear, joyously singing with heart bells all ringing, oh, won't it be wonderful there? Walking and talking with Christ the Supernal One, won't it be wonderful there? Praise
just to let y'all know, I forced the pianist to play that one with her fingers but by ear again. Amen. She's getting better. She said that I was going to kill her doing that. Some of them that are written in too high keys for me, so she'll play it by ear once in a while. Thank you, Boog, for doing that. That song reminded me when I was a little boy, being the son of an alto singer. I heard Miss Lulu sing those extra parts right there, standing by my mama, because I wasn't fit to sit by nobody else. I would hear my mama sing that, those harmony parts in that song, because it kind of brought back memories. Thank you for doing that. Loud enough for everybody could hear. And it just kind of brings back memory to me. But it will be wonderful there. I always like about there where the tempest will never be sweeping us. That's where the devil won't bother you no more. Man, it's going to be wonderful there, isn't it? Amen. No briar patches. No downs. All ups. Amen. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to John chapter 11. St. John chapter 11. As you look into the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, it's basically the trail that Jesus trod, and how he called people and how he done things and how he made many friends. And today it's the passage of Lazarus that died. Now, there's an account in the Bible where there was another Lazarus that died at the rich man's gate and all like this. But this Lazarus is Lazarus, God's friend. And you would think, in your mind that why did all this happen? Well, we can go back to the Old Testament and think, why did things happen for Job? And now why did things happen to Lazarus? But to kind of set the stage so your mind will be thinking that everything that happens is for the glory of God. Now, it may not be for your glory that you feel, but everything happens for a reason, and it's for the glory of God. For we as mankind were made for the glory of God. And I'll tell you, it's wonderful. And I'll say this, you women were made for the glory of their men. And I always remember when they spoke about hair and stuff like that, that a woman's hair, why? Well, it should be always fixed and pretty. But it is what she wears. The Bible calls it her glory. And not that it's short or long or anything like that, but it should distinct you between a male and a female. And not only that, you can follow your nose. I got about right here this morning fitting to pick out songs, and I smelt something. There wasn't nobody in here but me and Christy. As I got closer to the piano, I says, "Man, girl, you smelling fruity this morning." She says, "You wouldn't believe this. My husband went on his own and bought me some cologne." Yeah. And I am proud of him. It does smell a little bit about juicy fruit. I think he cheated and done that. But anyway, y'all don't know what juicy fruit is. I'm sorry. But anyway, if you have found John chapter 11, stand with us as we open God's word to get into the message this morning, that everything is for the glory of God. Everything is for the glory. Why? Because he made it, he built it, and we're made for his glory. In verse 1 it says this, "And a certain man was sick named Lazarus of Bethany, the town of Mary and her sister Martha. It was that Mary which anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. Therefore, his sister sent unto him," talking about Jesus, "Lord," he says, "behold, he whom thou lovest is sick." Let's pray. Father, as we look in your word this morning, God, the examples that lay before us in the road you trod in your mission down here on earth. God, we thank you for them. God, we can lean on them. We can learn from them. And God, we get a little clearer understanding sometimes while we go through and while people go through things. And it's all for the glory of God. Ultimately, it gets us to look to you where all our help and our strength come from. God, we thank you for that. Lord, this morning, hide us that we never say anything, Lord, but what thou havest to say. And be with us now. Be with the sick, the shut-ins. Be with the one that hears us by means of Facebook, Father. Bless them as they're in their home abode. God, be with us now. And all God's people said, amen. So we see a situation. God, Jesus had made friends already with Mary and Martha. And it depicts out right here, this Mary is the one that broke the alabaster box on Jesus' feet and wiped his feet with her hair. And it's a love relationship. She had already gotten to the point in her relationship and her faith in Jesus Christ that she understood the resurrection. She understood the resurrection, and the disciples were scuffing with that, because when she did this very thing, of course, Judas said it was a waste. And, you know, and it could have been sold and got money for it and gave to the poor. But Jesus said, the poor you'll have with you always. You won't always have me with you. So she knows something a little further down the road than you boys have understood by faith. So this was her. It sounds like a great relationship, you know. And why, how in the world, their brother name was Lazarus, and how in the world that something could happen, that he would even be sick. Well, they wasn't actually with him at this point. He was 4 days away, and he got sick, but they sent word to him to come. Well, it's kind of like what happens in our lives. You know, if you're not careful, you don't talk to God on a regular basis, but when you get feeling sick or something happens, you call on him. Well, let me tell you, he's not 4 days away. He's one prayer away. He's just one prayer away, and he's there for us to call on, but he's also there for us to love on and walk with daily. But we see here that the description of Lazarus here, he says, Lord, your best friend, the one that you love, and there was a relationship there that Jesus loved him. Why did Jesus love him? Well, Jesus loves us all. But Lazarus here was a follower of Jesus Christ, and he believed in him, and he trusted in him. He says, that one that you love, see, you think that would make matters more expedient. You know, it's kind of like for those of you that know a doctor. And you get sick and you say, well, I used to have one like that. I could make a phone call. And he actually, one time I was preaching, filling in at a church over there off Highway 40. And one day he talked when he come. He brought his girls to Sunday school. Then he would come once in a while. I met him outside. I was talking to just a dear friend. I used to hunt with him. He said, I want to give you my number. If you ever need anything, just give me a call, and if I can help you in any way. That made me feel good. It made me feel good that he would do that. But, you know, on the other hand, I was trying to get him convinced that there's another one that he could call on in a time of trouble that could help him with physical illness and his, most of all, his spiritual illness that he had, being a loss. But anyway, we have that friend, and his name's Jesus. And here, his friend is sick, and Jesus says this in verse 4. He said, when Jesus heard that he was sick, this sickness is not unto death. Well, you know, he was dying. Lazarus was dying. He knew he was ill, and the sisters come with the bad news to hurry up and come, because they wanted him here before he died. Well, I got news for you. God, in the form of Jesus Christ, is not only a doctor for the life while you're living. He's a doctor that handles that after you die. He's got medicine for both places. He can heal your physical body, and he can heal your spiritual soul. And that one's the most important, because the physical body is not going to live forever, but your spiritual body is going to live eternally. You're that person in you, you know, that person that you talk to yourself. I know if I asked you, does anybody ever talk to yourself in here? Well, I do. I talk to myself all the time. Me and my wife were traveling back home yesterday, and she said, why are you so quiet? Well, one thing, I was tired. I had them grandyoungers all day long, and I was tired, and coming back and not saying too much and all like that. But you know who I was talking to? I was talking to myself. I was thinking of all the things that needed to get done. We had to go by home and do this and do that. You know, all the things that were going on. So I was talking to myself, and you do the same thing. That when there's no sound, but yet there's things going on in your mind, who are you talking to? Well, one thing, you could be talking to the Lord Jesus. And another thing is, you could be talking to yourself. So you know there is a live being within your body. You know, and so it is the spirit that God put it within you. But this sickness, Jesus told his disciples. Now, he's 4 days away. The message comes to him. And he turns to the disciples. He says, now, this sickness is not unto death. This is not unto death. And he says, but for the glory of God. Now, Lazarus is going to die. Lazarus is going to die, but it's not a sickness unto death. I want you to know that. But he's going to go through what he's going to go through for the glory of God. And here it says, that the Son of Man might be glorified thereby. You know, sometimes there may be some ailing things in our life that happens to us. It's for the glory of God. You know, people watch us in bad times, whether it's a physical illness or it's an illness going on in your family or whatever. It could be a lot of things. But God's, you know, you wonder, why did God pick on, just say Job. Why did he pick on Job? I believe, he didn't pick on Job. I believe he used him for a great example in the Bible because he knew how strong Job was in his relationship with him, that he would never turn against him. So he was able to use the life of Job. You know, all the people of unbelief are sitting back watching us to see how we handle things during the pandemic, things during this energy crisis that we have, and all the things that's going on. They're watching the church. They're watching the God's people. They're watching to see how we do. Yeah, we complain gas is too high, electricity's too high, groceries is too high, and blah, blah, blah. It's all too high. But you know what? What we got on us is the Bible says that God will never leave us or forsake us. He's always here. He's going to be our friend until the end. We sing a song, what a friend we have in Jesus. And that what needs to be really lifted up there. Woo, what kind of friend we have in Jesus. Man, what kind of friend? He's a friend, the Bible says, that a stick closer than a brother, which means that even family is not as close to you as God is. And no way they can, because your family lives on the outside, but yet you hold them dear in your heart. Jesus lives on the inside. He is your heart, or should be your heart, and your heart should be in love with him. So he said, this is not unto death. This will happen because it might be glorified to the Heavenly Father. In verse 5 it says, now Jesus loved Martha and his sister and Lazarus. And we heard therefore that he was sick, and he abode 2 days still in the same place where he was. Now, Jesus does things for a lot of different situations. One, this would be a learning example for the disciples. They knew he had the bad news. He said this, the sickness is not unto death, but he didn't understand altogether. And he, instead of hurrying up and getting there, what did he do? The Bible says he abode where he was at for 2 more days. You know, could you imagine them Baptist boys being Baptist boys? I just say they're Baptist. His disciples, they going, he really ain't concerned about him, is he? I mean, he's not showing love. I thought he was his best friend. I thought he loved Mary. I thought he loved Martha. I thought he loved all this. And yet he ain't hurrying up and getting there. Well, listen, God don't have to get no hurry. He is the ultimate authority. You understand me? He has the ultimate power to do anything he wants. He don't have to get in a hurry. Sometimes he wants us to wait upon him so that he and his work can be done in our lives. And, you know, just when you ask for something, you might not always get it. Matter of fact, you might not never get it, because sometimes you ask for things that you don't need, and he'd go, nah, that ain't going to happen. You don't need that. That ain't going to do nothing but satisfy the flesh, and it'll take you away from me. I won't do that. And sometimes the Bible says that he does give us things, our heart's desires. And I do thank him for that. He don't have to give us nothing. I'll be honest with you. We're nothing worthy of getting anything from the Lord other than salvation. We don't deserve that, because we're just rotten to the core people, and our sins are insurmountable. But yet he made a way that we could get out of here. And then he went on to say in verse 7, he says, then after that saith he to his disciples, he says, let us go into Judea again. Now, here we're going to find that Jesus had a problem when he had been in Judea before. And we had talked about that. And that Jesus, they picked up stones to kill him because he had done some good deeds. But it wasn't the deeds that got him that way. It was because he said that he was the Christ. He is the Son of the living God. He is the God that they served, and yet they didn't want to accept him being the Messiah. And he'd gotten there, and the disciples said, now Lord, we can go anywhere. 2 places they didn't want to go. They didn't want to go through Samaria, and they didn't want to go through Judea. And they says, you know, I just remind you, last time we went in there, he says, they tried to kill you. You know, I believe Jesus could have come back in a way that I probably would. He says, but they didn't. Boy, they could have killed you, but they didn't. Boys, we're fine. Ain't nobody got skin up in there. We're fine. He needed to go through Judea, which was going to be out of the way from the way he was going. God works in mysterious ways. God does things for his glory. You got to know that. And I hope that's real in your life, because I feel like people, everybody right now, I think is going through stuff in this life. But God will work it out. We're not defeated down here by that. Don't get me wrong. You're not beat up and left alone and forgotten. God loves you. He cares for you. He'll be there until the end. He'll be there at the end, and he'll be there at the present time. You can reach out and feel his presence. He said, his disciples said unto him, he says, Master, the Jews sought to kill you, to stone thee, and goest thou thither again? And he said, well, yes, I am. See, God ain't afraid of anything, my friend. He don't have to be afraid of anything. Now, you know, what's kind of lingering on y'all's mind right now, if you watch the television in the last 8 hours, what's kind of lingering and everybody talking about? Well, it's kind of what old men do. Everything they talk about the first thing in the morning when they drink their coffee and they meet their buddies up there at Jerry J's or down at the Waffle House or somewhere like that, they talk about the weather. How much rain you get and all that. But we're worrying about this hurricane. Well, I tell you, God could turn that thing. God could make it do this. God could make it come through and not hurt a flea. But I'll tell you what, there's nothing that man can do to stop it. But we serve a Savior that can. And we do know if he decides not to, that we have there's a reason for it. Most every time there's tragedy, one of the first things that shows up in relief help is God's people in churches and missions going to places, fulfilling the need, and that's what God wants us to do. You know, somebody said, well, they deserve what they know. We deserve hell. Don't forget that. We deserve to go to hell, but we don't because of what he did on the cross. But here his disciples says, you know, last time we went there, it was going to kill us. But Jesus answered. And notice what he says here. He says, are there not 12 hours in a day? Now, you got to remember now, he knows there's 24 hours in a day. But what he's talking about is daylight. He says, if any man walk in the day, he stumbleth not because he seeth the light of this world. Now, there's a twofold meaning. He's talking about the sunlight, but Jesus Christ is the light of the world for the soul of mankind. The light that leadeth, the lighthouse, Sister Judith, on a hill. He is what we look for in time of trouble. He says, if a man walk in the daytime, he won't stumble. But he says this. He says, but if a man walk in the night, he stumbleth because there is no light in him. Why would he want to hide his supremeness? Why would he want to hide his majesty? Why would he want to hide his glory? Why would he want to fear and show fear to all men when he willingly gave himself up there in the Garden of Gethsemane to go there to be beaten on the whipping post and to carry the cross out to Golgotha there to lay down his own self and be nailed to a cruel tree? Why would he do that? Because he loved us. Because he loved us. So this going through this Judea was no big deal for him. But he says, listen, why would we do that? You know, we could sneak around. We could go by there. He says, I have a purpose in going there. Could you imagine, maybe, they don't know, none of the Bible ever say this, but could you imagine as they went back through Judea, some recognized him there again. Some recognized him. You know, people probably thronged him and they probably went with him, and it probably drawed to attention to those that wanted to kill him. But Jesus didn't let that hinder him because there was more need. We don't know any of the miracles that happened on his way. 4 days from where Lazarus was, Jesus stayed in one place. 2 days he spent going through Judea before he ever got to Lazarus. You know, and he's building up something. And one of the greatest miracles spoken of in the Bible here as far as the physicalness of what goes on in a human's life is the life that that we live, and he's going to raise him from the dead. But he says this, his disciple didn't want him to go, and he says, in verse 10, he says, these things said he. After that, he said unto them, our friend Lazarus sleeping, but I go and make awake him out of sleep. He says, then the disciple said, Lord, if he sleepeth, he does well. They give away the fact that they did not know that he was talking about spiritually. He was going to be dead physically. And then Jesus goes on to make the statement down there. If he point blank, I can see him as they walk in and people's coming to him and they're kind of on their way down there to where Lazarus is at. And all of a sudden, maybe he just turns and says, listen, guys, Lazarus, he's dead. Okay? He's been dead a while. I just want you to know he is dead. He's dead. He has no life in his body. He is dead. And, you know, for a minute, could you imagine, what is he going to do? I mean, he's dead and he's going there and he said these things. What in the world is he going to do? Then Jesus said it to them plainly, Lazarus is dead. He says, I am glad for your sakes that I was not there. You know, that kind of strikes you kind of funny, don't it? It's kind of like the doctor didn't get into your room and somebody was dying. You know, I just heard of a case just recently where somebody got money from a hospital during COVID that they stuck this person in a room. I didn't know this back then. I just found this out Friday, and the woman was put in there, and they were so busy they forgot her, and they had her oxygen thing on. But when they come back 2 hours later, her oxygen thing had failed, and then she had been out of oxygen so long that she had become a vegetable. She was brain dead basically, but her body lived and later died. You know, and all like that, it says, boy, they was upset with the doctors. They was upset because, you know, the family couldn't be in there to watch them and all like that. But see, God has a reason for all this. God had a reason for all that. Let me tell you, the mask had fell off of Lazarus. He was dead. He was dead. Matter of fact, they had done wrapped him in grave clothes and put him in the tomb. They done had him there, done had the mourners come. I mean, if you want to say they already had the funeral service and it was said and done, they done put the stone and rolled it over the place where he laid, my friend. He said it was done. He is dead. He is dead. Well, I got news for you. As long as there's Jesus, you know, a lot of times you hear a lot of preachers say that. I've said it myself. As long as there's breath, there's hope. You know, and what we're really referring to is being born again. You know, as someone that don't know Jesus, they're dying on the bed and someone can get to them, or if they just confess Jesus as their Savior on this side, you know, that's a very well put statement. But I got news for you. If you're a child of God, it don't matter whether you die in that bed or whatever, you live forever. Jesus talks about being born twice and die once. That's me. That's you that know Jesus. You're going to only die one time. But if you don't know Christ, you're going to be born once and you're going to die twice. What's the most scariest thing in the world for you right now? Is it dying or is it living? Well, I can tell you right now, dying is the most scariest thing we know, because it's a place, as they used to say on Star Trek, a place where no man has gone before. You hadn't and I hadn't. Other people have. But it's by faith we believe that Jesus is going to take care of that part because of what he did on the cross. And by faith we believe that. So he gets there and he finally gets to where they're at. And one of them comes tell Mary and Martha, says, listen, he's here. He's on his way. He's just outside of town here. And they run out there. And here's what her words was. She says, Master, if you'd have been here, my brother would not have died. You know, that's sad. Master, if you'd have been here, I know beyond a shadow of a doubt that you'd have healed him. You'd have blessed him. You'd have touched him. How many of us has ever thought that? Lord, if we'd have done this, we'd have done that. You know, I have a friend that kind of blamed himself because his mama passed away and they didn't find her that afternoon, and it was his normal routine to go by and check her about 9 o'clock every morning. He didn't that day and all like that. And here was my words to him. I said, the Lord didn't want you there that day. The Lord didn't want you there that day, my friend. Yeah, well, I just don't understand. If I'd have done that, no. God didn't want you in his way. If he'd wanted her to continue to live, she'd have been there. Wasn't a thing in the world he could have done. Listen, ain't nothing no doctor can do when it's your time and Jesus has pulled your number out of the hat and it's time for you to go, my friend. You just gone. They can put you on life support down here and pump you full of oxygen and run blood through you, but I can tell you right now, the soul of man has gone out of that body. It's either gone to be with the Lord or it's in a place called hell at that moment. You know, it tickled me back in the day. I remember when Michael Jackson was trying to figure out a way that he could be frozen in time, and then one day thaw him out and he could live again. I'm going, how stupid are you? I got the same theology, but it ain't freezing. I made it a point that I wouldn't burn after I died. And I made it a point to live with Jesus. And my eternity, my life after this life is already set in stone. And I believe it. That's why I have joy. That's why I don't really, things don't upset me. I ain't ready to go. I'm not ready to get on the bus and go now. But if he come by with the bus and it's my time, I am ready to go. I am ready to go. So Mary says, I wish you'd have been here. He wouldn't have died. And he says, he will live. He will live. She says, This is how much more she was advanced ahead of the disciples at this point. She says, I know in the resurrection he'll live. Now, my question is to you today, do you know in the resurrection that you will live? Do you know that this part about living? No, we're not talking about the flesh. He's not talking about, and she wasn't talking about the flesh. She was talking about the spirit. She was telling him, she says, well, I know that you're resurrection, and I know that he'll live, and he'll be with you forever. But I'm talking about if you'd have been here, he wouldn't have died the natural death. He wouldn't have died that death if you'd been here. And he looking at the crowd, and there was people weeping and all like that. Shortest verse in the Bible, Jesus does something here. It's the only time we know that he ever did it. The Bible says that Jesus wept. Jesus wept. You know, I've been rolling that part over in my head. You know, we cry at times. You know, hey, listen, if you can't cry, don't hold it back. You need to cry. It's kind of like when you put too much pressure on something, like if you hit your thumb with a hammer and you put too much pressure on it, something's going to squirt out the end of it, and it'll feel better once it quits hurting. I always say that. But let me tell you, you need to release some pressure. The reason why some people are so hard-hearted in this life, they won't allow themselves to humble themselves. God put tears in us. It shows humility. It shows we've gotten to the point that man can't do it for us. You know, men can't break men to broken heart. I heard a man say about a guy that was a good welder one time. He says, there's some, I'll tell you what, that rascal can weld anything, but only a broken heart he can't fix. Well, I can tell you who can fix the broken heart. Jesus Christ can fix the brokenhearted. He can take care of you. And at this time, the Bible says that Jesus, after looking around the crowd and all the people and the statement they made, could you imagine? I don't think he had much backup with his disciples because they had already doubted before they got there. And he says that Jesus cried. Some say, well, some non-believers. You know, the scripture was written for spiritual man. And some non-believers said, well, he was sad. That was his best friend. No, no, no. Jesus don't get sad at that. Over things he could control. What he couldn't control was the lack of faith. He couldn't control the lack of faith. Life, he can control. Death, he can control. He has the keys to that. Hell, he controls. He has the keys to that. He has the authority of that. But the Bible says that Jesus looked at them and he wept over it. You know, we don't even mention of him. We knew he probably cried out in agony on the cross and at the whipping post. We all like that. But as far as shedding a tear, we don't know that he ever did. But he hurt just like the normal man would hurt. But the only time we see Jesus saddened when he is the resurrection and the life is standing before them, and some of his most faithful people were in doubt that Jesus was going to do something for them that it had done got too late, my friend. It's never too late. You may have drunk enough liquor in this while to float the Titanic, but my friend, it's not too late. Jesus can help you. You may have done the ultimate sin, if, as far as mankind knows, is to kill somebody. But as long as there's breath, there's hope for you that, you know, say, well, there won't be no murderers in heaven. Well, I got news for you. There'll be some murderers in heaven that's gotten forgiveness in their life. You can murder without a gun or a knife or a baseball bat. The Bible says you can murder them with your mouth. You can kill people. You can kill their testimony with their mouth. Listen, if they are the same, then we all have been guilty of murder. And God can forgive that. The only thing the Bible says that Jesus can't is denying him and never accepting him. That's blasphemy. That means you deny him. And my friends, we'll all stand before him without excuse. He will show us in our background and all the things we have. When you stand before him, I think you're going to know it. You missed this opportunity, this opportunity, this opportunity. I knocked and you didn't answer. I rang the doorbell, you didn't answer. I hollered from the mountaintop. I showed up one time when you had cancer. I showed up during COVID. I showed up here and I showed up there. I showed up many times and in your life and you didn't respond to me. And now you're dead in the flesh, and now your soul dies in hell forever. So we look, and Jesus says, where have you laid him? And then one of them says, oh Lord, it's too late, right? It's too late. Oh Lord, he's over there, but he's been in there 4 days. He says, he probably stinks. You know, he probably did. I believe decay had already set in. I believe that the ointments and stuff they put on him was already done all they could do. You say you really believe that? He told the disciples he was not asleep. he was dead. Something being dead 4 days, my friend, it starts to rot unless it's encapsed in ice. And that wasn't the case here. And he said, roll away the stone. He was at that point so irritated. Where is he at? And the Bible says that he did this. He said, Lazarus, come forth. Woo. I'm kind of like that old gospel comedian. I'd like to have been there. I'd like to have been there. I'd have been that little boy running around shouting. I'd have been like that little boy running around and crying. And I'd been going, I knew it. I knew it. I doubted, but I knew it. Ain't he something? Well, my friend, he is something. We ought to be excited about him. We ought to be thankful, because if he had the power to do it then, he's got the power to do it right now. And I believe that with all my heart. You say, well, I've seen people and I've heard of people going up to a casket and trying to pray them out. Listen, you pray that the will of God be done. And if God sees fit to bring them out of there, listen, we all have been dead in our sins and trespasses. And he rose us up from the pits of hell. That's being like raised from the dead, my friend, because the Bible says that he will quicken us. He will give us life spiritually, that we'll never die again and we'll live forever. Quit worrying about this old flesh. Man, I'm my near 60 years old. My knee hurts. My left shoulder. I reached over to get my Bible early this morning. And it reminded me, I got something going on there. I don't know what it is. As long as it don't affect my trigger finger and the way I set my hook, I'm just going to leave it alone for a while. I'm afraid of them replacement parts, brother. I'm praying, man. I just want to go home to be with Jesus like I am. But anyway, if it gets bad enough, I have to do something. But I said, you know what? My wife, she talks about her feet hurt. Well, she ought to. She stands on them all day long. But it's got something to do with the birthdays. It's got something to do with the birthdays. And I was explaining this, and I don't know if this was a lost boy or not. I just when he cracked the safe open, I just began to talk. And I told him, I said, you know what? We ain't all going to be, nobody's going to stay here. He had told me about a friend that he had, and that this man died, and this person was going through some stuff because he was working with this guy, and he died. And I said, well, let me tell you something, son. He's a young boy. I said, let me tell you. I said, we ain't all going to stay here. I said, man, I'm nearly almost 60 years old. And I said, I can tell you right now, it seemed like yesterday I was 20-something years old. I just married this beautiful girl, and all of a sudden I'm 60 years old. Time ain't going to wait on us. We're going to get old. If not, Jesus come back, we're going to die. It's once appointed in the man after die. But it don't stop there. But after that, the judgment is for all those, us and the ones that die as sinners. And he kind of looked at me funny. He says, you're right. We all can't stay here. I says, yeah, you're a young man. I says, tomorrow you'll be 40. And your next birthday you'll be 60. I says, what Ecclesiastes says about that, that our life is but a vapor. It's here today. It's gone tomorrow. How many of you gray-headed folks in here has got some thoughts? If you could call back about 20 years, there's some things that you'd like to do that you can't do now. The Bible warns about that. Do it while you're able. Do it while you can. You don't miss it till it's gone. You don't miss your mobility. You don't miss your sight. You don't miss your hearing. You don't miss your taste. You don't miss it till it's gone. Hey, this old fat boy lost his taste during COVID. That was tragic. As you can tell, it come back. But a second chance of eternal life won't happen. You die without him. You die all of a sudden without him. The next place you'll see is a place called hell. Jesus is able. He's more than willing to do what he said he'd done for us on the cross. He said, if you believe in me, you believe in the Father also. He says, in my Father's house up there, there's many mansions. He says, I'll go to prepare a place for you. Now, who is he talking about? Each one of us. That you was whosoever. He says, and if I go to prepare a place, I'll come again. Well, who's he coming for? Well, the Bible says he's going to come for them in the grave first. It says then the ones that are alive will be snatched away, raptured, caught up. Hallelujah. I've never flown but twice in my life. I had to fly air, then I had to fly again to get back. But I am ready. I got my flight tickets to go to heaven. And when he calls me, I'm coming. I'm going. And if I just happen to jump just before that happens, I'm going to be ahead of all y'all. Just remember that. So you need to practice the rapture. Even as well, Brother Jamie, I can't even jump no high enough to get my toes off the ground. Well, from where I'm standing right now and to right here is a little bit closer to glory. Amen. And we're one day closer today than we were yesterday. There's no time like right now. The Bible says the day is the day of salvation. Why did he say it that way? Because we're none promised tomorrow. You need Jesus. You need him now. You need him now. Have that security sewed up. And remember what he said. There's no man can pluck you out of his hand at that point. No man. And it won't. Lazarus comes forth. He didn't smell dead. He didn't look dead. He told him, he said, man, get them grave clothes off of him. He says, only dead people wear that. He's alive. He says, feed him. He's hungry. Dead people don't eat. Live people do. So all this happened for what? That Jesus may be magnified at that moment. And we always say that moment. But let me say this, at this moment. For those of you who believe. Some believe it's fairy tale. Some believe it's just wrote in there. Could you imagine how did all this go and point to the cross and it happened and started so many years ago? And it says the same thing and it means the same thing and it still has power today because it's real. How many fads and fashions has come and gone? You know, I remember the miniskirt days. I remember the bell-bottom days. I remember the Daisy Duke short days. I remember all these things, and some of them come back in. I seen a girl the other day walking by me. She had bell bottoms about that big. And I remember the words my daddy said when bell bottoms got in a big vent. He says, if she jumped out of an airplane, she would never hit the ground. Well, all that will come and go. But salvation remains the same. What it means to be born again remains the same thing as it did over 2,000 years ago. He told Nicodemus, he said, you must be born again. And that's what I'm going to say to you in closing. You have to be saved. Now, I can't do it. But he can. And he wants to. And you can't get saved just when you want to. People think, well, I'll wait on my birthday. No. It's when the Spirit starts bothering you. When something inside of you, and I need to. I feel funny. I don't like. You know what happens? A lot of people, they get that feeling. Just like that conversation with that little boy, I thought I never mentioned salvation, but he was kind of chiming in like he'd been to Sunday school once or twice in his life, you know. He was kind of chiming in, and all of a sudden our conversation got short. What happened? I believe the Spirit was dealing with him. You're either going to walk to it and accept it, or you're going to walk away. Make that decision today to walk to it, accept Christ. Let's stand. Father, today we do thank you. God, the example of what happened in Lazarus' life, God, it could happen to us. And God, you choose sometimes to use people. But God, the ultimate thing was that you got glorified because you were conquered. You conquered death, hell, and the grave. You died and your spirit rose you up. You rose Lazarus up and then you rose yourself up. That self-same spirit that rose Jesus up will raise us up in the Spirit. God, let us make sure that our calling and election sure, that we could leave here today knowing beyond a shadow of a doubt that if we were to die, that we would go to heaven. Help us, Lord, let that be on our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand and sing. About every time I hear when we sing that song, I look at the ransom part. You know, a ransom is what you pay to get something set free. And Jesus Christ paid. I was held captive in my sins and on my way to hell, and he paid my ransom by dying on the cross. And it says in that song that there's a healing stream of blood that still flows from Calvary's mountain. It was the blood that ran from Jesus, and it'll save you today. Don't forget that. Y'all have a blessed day. Enjoy this nice weather we're having, okay? If you don't like it so cool, just wait till about dinner. It'll get your temperature directly, all right? Ain't that something? It's amazing. But God bless y'all. Y'all have a good... Brother Lamar, if you would dismiss us, please.